after 22 years of working in Somalia, this decision to withdraw your programs from Somalia completely, what forced MSF to take that decision?
MSF is an international humanitarian organization that works in conflict and crisis situations. We're in the business of going to people in crisis rather than leaving them behind. And hence, this is one of the most difficult things and most difficult decisions that we as an organization and me as a general director for this organization have had to take in years. Recently, our Spanish colleagues were released from 21 months in captivity, and this has caused MSF to think long and hard about what the situation in Somalia is today and the possibilities of us to work. And we've had to come to the conclusion that given the multitude of severe and violent incidents that have affected MSF over the past 5 years, as well as the structural inability of Somali leadership and authorities to prevent these incidents from occurring or to address them when they occur, we can no longer safeguard our activities and our staff in Somalia today, and hence we've had to take the very painful decision to leave.
As we know, there's now in place in Mogadishu an internationally recognized government. MSF raised this issue with the government, and what was the government's response?
We have informed the government just today about our decision to leave. The decision to leave is based on our experience over the last number of years with a variety of groups, a variety of authorities, none of which have been able to assist us effectively in the prevention or the resolution of these violent incidents that have affected MSF over the past number of years.
Since 1991, in total, MSF has lost 16 staff members. Has it not always been this dangerous? And what would you like to say to the local population who would say, we need MSF?
With regards to those Somalis who are now left behind, I say to them that we deeply regret leaving them behind in this still terrible crisis situation. We felt that we were forced to do so for reasons of insecurity. And I would like to ask them to work with their authorities and their leaders in order to ensure that in the future perhaps better conditions are created for humanitarian organizations to work. Somalia has always been a dangerous place, but now we believe there's a limit to what we can accept, and the conditions that allow and permit humanitarian assistance in Somalia are no longer there. I myself worked in Somalia in 1992. I came in at the time of the Great Famine and the American intervention Restore Hope. And it was a very dangerous place. It was a tragic place at the time. People were heavily affected by this famine. They were dying in droves, and the work that we did was made incredibly difficult by the insecurity that prevailed. However, we were able to work with community leaders. We were able to work with local authorities, such as they were, in order to be able to create conditions that permitted us and myself to set up medical programs that had a very, very positive impact on the population at that time. I can also see from that experience, I can see today, that the same conditions that allow us to carry out these activities safely do no longer exist. The multitude of heavy security incidents that have affected MSF over the last couple of years are testimony to that. The two latest incidents are only the two latest incidents in a series of severe attacks on our staff, and this is basically the basis upon which we have felt compelled to make the decision to leave Somalia today.
Two of your colleagues were killed in Mogadishu. The individual allegedly behind the killing is walking free in Mogadishu. Who do MSF blame for that?
We were very reassured when the government initially apprehended the person and sentenced him to jail. Since then, however, he has been released and he's now walking free. And the fact that a killer that has been apprehended and sentenced by the government is able to walk free, that undermines the trust that we can have in the government and the ability of the government to takes decisions that can help prevent and safeguard humanitarian assistance.
We know the situation in Somalia. There's still no strong enough government to provide these facilities that MSF are providing across the whole of Somalia. What would be the consequence on the local populations?
In the absence of MSF's facilities, which we'll be shutting down over the next weeks, there's a little to no alternatives to for the Somali people of the communities where we're working to seek medical care. So the impact is very, very heavy. We're leaving from a situation which still continues to be one of the major humanitarian crises of today. And this is one of the reasons, this is the main reason why the decision is such a heavy one for MSF. We, of course, are committed to the Somali people. So we would look forward to the Somali leadership, the authorities, into the future to assume effective leadership and effective way of making sure that humanitarian assistance is going to be safeguarded in the future, more so than it is today.
The last two colleagues were abducted from Dadaab in northern Kenya. Would MSF stop working in Dadaab? We know Dadaab is the largest refugee camp in the world.
We feel comfortable for now to continue our activities in Dadaab in Kenya, as well as in Dolo Ado in Ethiopia. The ability of the authorities in Kenya and in Ethiopia to be able to put in place measures and controls that can protect humanitarian organizations are ones that we are that we have a greater degree of confidence in than in Somalia.
And what also happens to those patients who are currently receiving long-term treatment? For example, those patients who are receiving TB treatment.
Well, you know, we try, in as much as we possibly can, we try to complete the treatment of those patients that we have admitted today in our facilities. This goes the same to people who and children who are suffering from malnutrition, as well as those who have been admitted for surgery, as well as those that have been admitted for simple TB. For new patients, however, we will no longer admit them into our facilities, and therefore new patients can no longer seek treatment with MSF.
The Somali government and the international community are saying the situation in Somalia is the best it has been for the last 23, 22 years. Do you agree?
Our belief is that the humanitarian situation in Somalia continues to be incredibly heavy. Our experience is that we see tens of thousands of patients, you know, every single month in all our facilities coming in who are in desperate need of medical care. We don't share the same degree of optimism that comes out of some of the conferences and some of the statements that are being discussed on Somalia today.
Since the international community, the Somali government and the African Union are saying the situation is improving, and to certain extent you disagree, do you think they should provide more in terms of security for MSF?
In the first instance, I mean, they have to assume their responsibility towards the population to make sure that the population itself is secure and is not affected by conflict and violence in the way that it is today. That is the first and primary responsibility. Secondarily, they have a responsibility towards organizations like us that are there to assist the population, but also the government itself and the authorities itself, to make sure that the work that we do is made possible.
My final question would be, would MSF review the decision, and if so, how often would you be reviewing the decision to withdraw?
This is a decision that that we haven't taken lightly. It is an incredibly heavy decision. It is not a decision for the next weeks or months. Our commitment to the Somali people is undiminished, and we would gladly resume our activities, provided the conditions that permit safe resumption of activities and presence of our staff are created, and at the moment they're absent.